The following is an interview with Sonny Landham recorded at the November 2007 HorrorHound Weekend in Indianapolis, Indiana. Horror fans will remember Sonny as Billy from the hit movie Predator. He is famous for playing tough guys including Billy Bear in 48 Hours and Chink Webber in Lock Up with Sylvester Stallone. We had a lot of fun with Sonny and we hope you enjoy the interview.
You probably know Sonny from Predator.
Oh, I thought you were saying I probably know Sonny. I was saying, well, I've known him.
Just for a few years.
I thought I knew him.
Listeners, you probably know Sonny from Predator.
A senior moment. Susie would understand.
And he is actually also in the Warriors.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So it has been a wild ride for him.
Yeah.
I hear that you have an interesting Jean-Claude Van Damme story that we have to hear
Which
about.
Which one?
Anyone you would like to tell.
Anyone that you would like to tell.
The one about him getting the job in Predator.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
When he went in and to interview with Joel Silver, the producer, and his kicks, you know, his legs and everything, he's dancing, and he was kicking the ceiling. And this was before John had ever done a movie. And so Joel Silver says, hire him, you know. Hires a guy, and goes out, and Jean-Claude's about 5'10", 5'11". And they've hired him now to be the protagonist or the predator, whichever you want to say, for people who are 6'5", 6'6", 6'4", 6'2". Arnold's 6'2". Carl Weathers 6'2". Bill Duke and Jesse. Jesse's 6'5", and I think Bill Duke 6'5 or 6, I'm 6'4, and Shane Black and Richard Chavez, they're about 6 feet. But you have all this, you know, beefcake, and then you have this, you know, nicely built, shorter guy. I mean, it doesn't work for all of us to be beating up on him. You don't look too good if he's beating up on you.
And you look like a bully.
So, yeah. Why do you pick on the Predator so much?
So the way they were shooting this to get the camouflage effect, where you have to overlay film to get that effect. The only color you can blot out and make it look like out of focus or blur is fuchsia red. So he was going to be wearing a fuchsia red stretch a stretch what is that, polyester,
not very manly.
And well, you saw how the Predator finally came out with that silver.
That was pretty manly.
No, the silver, but I mean it's the same thing. But you wouldn't have seen him like that. It was just so they could blot him out.
Right.
So Jean-Claude gets, they decide, well, wait a minute, he's too small. So they beef up this suit with all this padding. And now it looks like the San Diego chicken. you know, that yellow San Diego.
Not scary.
Yellow San Diego chicken that in fuchsia red. Well, it's not a scary thing because you never see it. See, all you're going to see is that big a blur.
Yeah.
Right.
But in doing things, you know, the kicks and this, that, and the other, well, they padded up that suit, and it also had the head with the bill, just like the San Diego chicken. And the only space was just around the face, was there an opening in the neck for him to breathe. You know, like just the face, the cutout around the eye, down the chin, back up, you know. So he doesn't know this until he gets to Puerto Vallarta in April and try on the suit. And Jean-Claude Van Damme is claustrophobic.
Oh, God.
That's no good.
Now they get out of trying to shoot with this computer camera where they shoot the Predator making moves. And then they cut, and the camera goes back and makes the same moves in the scenery without the predator in there so that they could overland. And Jean-Claude gets in there, and they say, kick, kick, kick. He can't kick, he can hardly walk in this house.
Nobody had thought of that.
No, nobody thought about this. So now he's waddling around on the set.
And go, like a chicken?
Yeah, do this, do that. We can't, more like a oversized duck. And so Joel Silver's screaming at him, and he's screaming back, and so now they're trying to shoot with just the scenery, and I want out of the suit. I can't breathe. And Joel Silver said, we don't have time. He said, I got to get out. I can't breathe. Finally, Silver fired him. And Silver fired him. He said, get me a stuntman. And he put a stuntman in there. And now the executives, this was a film that they said that they would shoot within 8 weeks for under $18 million. Mm-hmm. 12 weeks later, millions over budget. They're sitting in the screening room at Fox watching nothing but this fuchsia red
chicken
waddling around on the set, and then all this scenery with nothing happening in it, just the scenery. And you have them coming down and going, what's going on down here? And all these crews that were, had all these crews going. There was a second unit crew with a stuntman. There was the heat unit. And then there was first unit. And I mean, you had the whole crew. You had a whole crew for each, camera, each one of these different types of shooting. So, they shut Predator down after 12 weeks and they'd finish it on Warner Brothers' back lot.
Oh, my God. They had no idea.
And they decided that this wasn't going to work with the chameleon type of idea. So they redesigned the Predator, and they liked what they had with Arnold. And so they went back in January after we'd shut down in June of 86. They went back in January of 87, shot for 5 weeks with Arnold and Peter Kevin Hall. You know where Arnold slides down, and when he goes out into the water, hits the water, that's Blanca. That's the southern tip of Mexico.
Okay.
And so they shot down there for 5 weeks with Peter Kevin Hall, who was Harry and Harry and the Hendersons.
Right.
And
Harry and the Hendersons.
With a redesigned Predator, and that's what you got for the Predator.
Wow.
That's
one
hell of a story.
An amazing story.
Yeah.
Wow.
I can just imagine Jean-Claude Van Damme saying, I cannot do this. Take it off of me.
Cried.
Oh, I mean, there were a lot of stories on Predator.
Oh, I bet. I mean,
a bunch of guys in the jungle. I bet there were no stories at all.
Yeah, I heard you were a rowdy bunch.
No, not really. I mean, there was no time to be rowdy.
Oh, I can imagine with that kind of shooting schedule.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we were going anywhere from about 45, 50 minutes a day to and back, and another 50 minutes back to an hour and a half out and an hour and a half back.
Wow.
And still shooting. I mean, you're coming in dead tired. You're seeing yourself coming and going.
Wow. Oh, I imagine.
And we shot out way out by the airport where they're building up Puerto Vallarta now. We were shooting way out past that. And then we were shooting way out at the other end, out where John Houston had his house. We'd cut off and go up into the jungle out there. And then we shot, the helicopter scene. Now they're just at the beach that John Houston's house overlooked. And, and they have if you ever watch Predator, it changes in the beginning. When we get off we get out of the helicopter. Well, if you notice, I'm standing up when we start in, and then it cuts back and I'm sitting down, and there's no bar up there to hold on to, because the...
my hair's different outfit.
Oh, yes.
Tonight it was day.
What happened was that They went down and they set up all of these landing pads. And they didn't know anything about the tides. They set them up, and they were washing out.
Oh, no.
And they were, oh, yeah.
I can't believe this movie even got finished.
Yeah.
I mean, we got this whole speech when we cut up shooting in the jungle. They carried us down to the beach for lunch. And they gave us this whole speech. Said, you know, now we're going to have to get, need you, everybody standing right by the camera, because we've got to get 6 shots this evening. And I said, what? You think we've been trying to sabotage the movie so far? Well, you need our cooperation? What have we been giving you? You know, you want 6 shots? You haven't got 6 shots in a week. I mean, how do you expect to get them in 2 hours? And so we get up there, and the helicopters, you know, supposed to coming in. We're getting off the helicopters, and we take off, and Arnold's up in front of us, and they're running, John McTiernan and Rick Waite, the cameraman. They were the cinematographer, rather. They're running behind the Arnold's Jeep, and somebody in our Jeep said, what do you think they're doing? Somebody said, well, they probably forgot to turn the camera on. That's right. They forgot to turn the camera on.
And Arnold's just driving away.
So, you know, and the helicopter pad is washing away. And so, you know, finally it was all not usable. Couldn't get back to shooting because the water, the tides are coming in. And, you know, the Jeeps, you know, the waves are coming up, slapping the Jeeps. So they had to scrap shooting for the night on that.
Oh, no.
Come back and do it later. And so we actually did it one day, the arrival. And then you see us coming up. And that's where part of it's sitting down, part of it's standing up. And, you know, different vehicles.
Well, how do you remember, though, you know? Forget it.
I mean, you have continuity people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's
all right.
I mean,
that's,
but the problem was
we're probably tearing their hair out.
It was what they got in Mexico and could get running.
Right.
That was the problem.
I am never going to look at Predator the same again.
No. Yeah, I mean,
it's a great movie.
I mean, if you knew how much of that movie was standing around with crew and talent with dirty underwear.
I don't know if I want to know that.
In a fuchsia bodysuit.
And throwing up all over the place.
Oh, my goodness.
Because
Montezuma's revenge?
Oh.
Oh, wow. God, I don't know
whose revenge. Well,
somebody's revenge.
Somebody.
Evil happened.
Water purification system went out while we were down there shooting. And they didn't tell us. And
man, they say Poltergeist was cursed.
Yeah.
Predator was cursed.
Did they end this shoot just by punching you in the face?
Was that your payment?
Thank you.
You know, Arnold got dehydrated. He was, you know, up like a pretzel.
Oh,
I mean, we were all, every one of us were down.
Wow.
And they were still trying to shoot. And, I mean, it was just...
You know,
you wouldn't want to be.
Really...
There weren't many visitors to that set.
No, I can imagine that. I bet there were.
It's a really intense movie. I wonder how much of what comes out on screen is a result of what you guys were going through on
the
set.
Troubles.
I mean, just the
you can tell. Yeah, you guys are struggling.
I'm sitting there talking to the sound man. The sound man had worked on all these old great movies, Veracruz. What was that Lee Marvin did with Burt Lancaster down there? Something Men. Lee
Sorry,
J. Cobb. They went down to get the woman.
Was it Trigger Man?
No, it was. Some of these great westerns that were done down there. And this man was talking about it, and I'm sitting there on an apple box talking to him, and I moved my arm, and boom! I felt like something. I got stuck with a pin. I thought it was. Looked down. It's a scorpion.
Oh my God!
I got bit by a scorpion.
It might have been just time to pack it up and go home.
It was so far out, the doctor gives me a shot, and he says, now you may be dead, in a half hour.
Oh, that's a
it's good bedside manner.
We're well, just peeling away the layers of the onion here, folks.
But that had to come through an interpreter. He didn't speak English.
Oh,
so it took a second to find out you were going to die.
Third hand.
Did you film in hell?
Well, I mean, that's what I'm telling you. This film took 10 years off everybody's life.
Have you seriously ever considered writing a book? Because this stuff would make an amazing book.
I'm working on one now about my lawsuit with the government. I'm suing the government for $310 million.
For what?
Really?
Yeah, for illegally incarcerated.
Wow.
And another story.
It was reversed. Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals said I committed no crime and it should never have been brought to trial. Go to sonnylandham.com.
Sonnylandham.com.
Yeah, I was looking at your site. That's really an interesting case. I understand you live in Kentucky, right?
Yes.
We're from Cincinnati, Ohio. Uh-huh. So we're right across the river from you there. And I was reading up on that about all these difficulties you had when you left, when it was overturned and you went back out into the world to even get a job. It sounds like you went through a real struggle.
Oh, yeah. No, nobody. See, I have a daughter, 11-year-old daughter in Kentucky, too. That's, you know, I'm staying there. I'm not going to leave her.
Right.
But, no, I'm suing them, and I'm writing a book about it. I don't know. I'm thinking about calling it Sonny Landham, Pro Se by Sonny Landham.
Yeah.
And, but I've also thought about writing one called On Location.
Yeah.
I would buy it.
I would buy that for sure.
You know, and just take each picture and write different, what page, whatever it is, of the stories.
Right.
Because I sang on Southern Comfort. Michelle Phillips and I, there was a big party for Predator. They cleaned out a bar down there and rented a bar for the night. And Michelle Phillips and I get up to sing Me and Bobby McGee. And I'm playing it on the guitar. And we're both singing it. She thought I was playing it. And I thought we were both singing it. And, we were too drunk to know what we were doing. But to show you that the cast was drunker than we were, the cast and crew were drunker than we were, they applauded.
They loved it.
There you go.
But, I mean, how many people got to sing a duet with Michelle Phillips?
That's pretty
amazing. Well, the Mamas awesome. And Papas.
Wow.
That's awesome. You also were in 48 Hours with Nick Nolte and Eddie Murphy,
yeah.
Right? And that was your big break, is that right?
Oh yeah, that was the come out for everybody.
Yeah, that was an amazing flick. What was that like to work with those two on the set of that film?
Well, I mean, Eddie was just turned 21 and really a nice guy, but he's a young guy. I mean, he's night going in playing his video games. it was just Nolte and I became good friends. Remar was a good friend.
Yeah.
And Remar and I were, working on our parts together.
Okay.
And it was a real good communication, between Remar and I. We just clicked.
Did you guys meet on the Warriors, or had you?
Yeah, we met on the Warriors.
You met on the Warriors?
Yeah.
And they put us together on 48 Hours.
Yeah.
And it just happened to be a great bad guy team.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, that film was number two in 82, 83. It was the number two film behind Tootsie. It made $110 million, so 45 million tickets at the box office.
Nice. It was it's one of the best, I think, all-time buddy cop movies. I think that was it. That was like the beginning of the real buddy cop.
That was it. Changed genre, because everybody back then was the Dirty Harry type, a bullet Steve McQueen. You know, they're anti-civil rights for criminals. They're always in trouble with the boss. And here you had the guy in trouble, but his partner was a fish out of water, and it's an action comedy.
Yeah.
And it was tremendously conceived. Walter Hill did a beautiful job on that film.
Yeah, he's you know, it's funny, like, I had never made the connection that the Warriors, until recently, that the Warriors and 48 Hours are both Walter Hill movies. And, like, it made sense in hindsight, looking back, just the way the look of both movies, just that real urban
Walter,
look.
Well, 48 Hours, Warriors. Mm-hmm. No commercial TV network would play that picture on its about, you know, buy it for a movie of the week. Due to the fact they were saying it was too violent, they wanted to ban it in the theaters. They didn't want people seeing it, and it's off of a Greek play.
Right.
You see, it's. Our critics, they don't know the classics. But anyway, it was a brilliant idea.
Doing the comic book cut-ins and things like that. What a great idea.
No, I'm talking about with Warriors.
Yeah, the story in general.
It was a moving story trying to get home.
Yeah.
And David Patrick Kelly.
Yeah.
I mean, this man in person, you can dress him in a Hawaiian shirt, put him up against a white wall, and you'd never notice him.
he
hardly speaks. And when he does, he talks about going up to his room and cooking some microbionic rice. I'm not knocking any of this, except you put him on a set and you say, my God, get a straitjacket. And every role he's ever played. And then he walks off the set and he goes and says,
I'm
going back to my trailer and eat some microbionic rice. And he dresses like a college professor. I mean, is this guy right? I mean, is this schizophrenic? Chuckling hot. And I say that with love. I mean, I think he's a tremendous actor. It's just the difference.
Yeah.
And, Luther, you know, banging him into the door. Luther, that looks like it hurts to me.
That movie's enjoyed a great some sort of cult resurgence over the last few years.
Oh, yeah.
The video game, and you guys are showing up at conventions. What's that been like?
But, well, I was going to say that, you know, Warriors, they wouldn't even play until 48 Hours came out and smashed the screen. And they start saying, this was done by Walter, 48 Hour hit. And they have it immediately. Within, we came out in the 12th of December. And in February, it was on a network television. Warriors.
Really?
Yeah.
You know, the first time I saw the Warriors, it was a Saturday morning matinee on broadcast
TV.
So the first version of the Warriors I saw had the alternate opening and everything, you know, that they had for TV. And I hadn't seen the original theatrical cut until, you know, just years ago. And the appreciation for that movie, it's just like, it's like one of the most entertaining action movies ever made.
Oh yeah, it is.
It never stops.
Personally, one of my favorite films.
Yeah.
Well, it's one of these. I've never timed Warriors. It's under an hour and a half.
Mm-hmm.
48 Hours is 96 minutes, and you sit down in your seat and it's ba bam, ba bam, ba bam, ba bam. You never have a chance to go, why did they say this?
Yeah.
And Deborah, you know, we were talking about it the other day. I mean, here yesterday, today, I guess it was. And, seeing these people from Warrior, I mean, it really brought back some times.
I bet.
How long have we got?
You go.
Okay.
It's your night.
In New York, down in Brooklyn, there's a place called Junior's Delicatessen. Here I am. We're shooting, and this is still for lunch. We're shooting up there, and they go break for lunch. Nobody on the Warrior set. Nobody came to take my gun, and I had a real gun in my.
Oh goodness!
You know, for blame.
New York was different then.
Yeah.
Well, no, they forgot to
come. Giuliani.
And so, you know, we didn't change clothes. And we're walking across the street. Some of the crew and I were walking across the street and trying to get across the street and all these cars. And I just throw up my hand and, you know, I go, well, these people think I'm a cop. What? I mean, you know, we're just like a New York cop.
Why do they keep stopping?
And we go into Junior's, and I don't know how many. It was 200 or 300 people at least in that restaurant. And there were steps going up to the restrooms. And I go in there, and I'm going, oh, no, I shouldn't. But I can't. I just, oh, I've got to do it. I got to go to the bathroom, come out. And as I step out, at the top of those steps, I yell, I can't take this world any longer.
Oh,
and I chuck out the pistol and go, snap, snap, snap.
Oh, my God.
And I go, oh, heck. Stop it in my, stop it in the holster.
Pointing at his head.
And I walk back to the table. Well, when this happened, you hear this crash, bang. You know, people knocking food in the table, going under the table. And
I would do that. I think I would have written a book.
It was a John. It was a John Wayne barroom brawl.
Oh my goodness!
You know, you look like that. You know, with all this happening, what?
There's
some whipping.
It's yeah. free.
Oh,
you
my
wanna,
lord!
If you want to get in there,
he's enamored.
No, I think I could pass.
Okay.
When do they use cotton candy?
Yeah. Oh my goodness!
Not with her. I mean, oh, she's vicious.
Oh, she means it.
Oh. She really, really means it.
Oh, lady!
She wouldn't snuggle with you afterwards.
This is a G-rated performance. Oh. Should be a G-rated performance.
It doesn't have to be.
Anyway, don't worry. Nobody will say anything. It's only a white male in there. Anyway, all these people. I saw one guy just pull his soup off into his lap.
You really scared some people.
And so I go back and I sit down. And this big guy, you know, with the apron on everything, he goes up and he goes, hey, is you a real cop? I go, no, I'm just an actor coming in here for lunch. Get the heck out of my restroom. I said, I'll get you. Take it. Get the heck out of my restroom.
Oh my,
I went, okay. And I walked out. He probably had to buy a new set of
plates. And
yeah. Oh, God, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I probably had to hire a new staff.
For some
yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'm sure there's somebody there that's telling a story of the time they saw a guy shoot himself in the head and survive.
That was the damnedest thing.
Yeah, somebody's telling their grandkids.
This cop tried to kill himself. He had stress on the job.
And if Sonny says this guy was big, I mean, he was probably about 9.5 feet.
I mean, you know, he looked like Bruno, the enforcer, you know, for the mob. You know, he comes over and goes, hey, you a real cop?
Forget about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, what about it?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess next time you say yes.
I just should have said that.
But he knew you were out of bullets, so he probably would have tried to whoop your butt anyway.
You're a cop out of ammo.
Yeah.
So what are you currently working on? I hear you're working on Disintegration. Is that correct?
Disintegration.
Uh-oh, I guess that's not right.
No. What is Disintegration?
Fact checker fired.
Uh-oh.
Fact checker done. Well, IMDb, you're out of here.
SonnyLandham.com, and we can talk, and you're talking about the book on there and things that you're working on.
I'm working on the book.
Okay.
I still, you know, do a show or two like this around.
Okay.
And I still dabble in politics and go and make speeches.
All right. That's right.
Yeah, and I can't wait for that
amazing
book.
I know. You should really.
Well, the one
on location.
On location, yeah.
Whatever book you write.
I'll
I'm in line.
Yeah. We're in.
It'd be good stuff.
We should spell his name, too, by the way. It's Landham. There is an H in there.
Are you spelling deficient, folks?
.com.
And Sonny is with an O. Sonny.
.com.
Thank you so much.
Yes,
thank
you.
We have been a lot of fun.
So much.
You all have a great evening.
You too.
God bless. Thank you. Along the dusty Winnemucca Road, when along came a semi with a high-end canvas-covered load, If you're going to win a muckamack with me, you can ride. And so I climbed into the cab and then I settled down inside. He asked me if I'd seen a road with so much dust and sand, and I said, listen, I've traveled every road in this here land. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Reno, Chicago, Fargo, Minnesota, Buffalo, Toronto, Winslow, Sarasota, Wichita, Tulsa, Ottawa, Oklahoma, Tampa, Panama, Mattawa, La Paloma, Bangor, Baltimore, Salvador, Amarillo, Tocopilla, Barranquilla, and Padilla. I'm a killer. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Boston, Charleston, Dayton, Louisiana, Washington, Houston, Kingston, Texarkana, Monterey, Faraday, Santa Fe, Tallapoosa, Glen Rock, Black Rock, Little Rock, Oskaloosa, Tennessee, Tennessee, Chicopee, Spirit Lake, Grand Lake, Devil's Lake, Crater Lake, Beach Lake. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Of travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Louisville, Nashville, Knoxville, Ombabaka, Shepherdville, Jacksonville, Waterville, Costa Rica, Pittsfield, Springfield, Bakersfield, Shreveport, Hackensack, Cadillac, Fond du Lac, Davenport, Idaho, Jellicoe, Argentina, Diamantina, Pasadena, Catalina, Sea, Guatemala. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I've traveled, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Pittsburgh, Parkersburg, Gravelburg, Colorado, Ellensburg, Rexburg, Vicksburg, Eldorado, Larimore, Atmore, Havistaw, Chattanooga, Chaston, Nebraska, Alaska, Opelika, Baraboo, Waterloo, Kalamazoo, Kansas City, Sioux City, Cedar City, Dodge City, what a pity. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I've traveled, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been everywhere.